Members, we have reached the appointed hour to start. This is the 17th meeting of the Bills Committee. We have had 16 sessions, totaling 32 hours of meeting, not counting the two public hearings. Let me finish first. We're now on cross six. We'd like to complete the scrutiny of crosses 5, 6, 7, and 8 by the 7th of May. If you have, if you want to move amendments, you can give your amendments to the president for a ruling, or if you want me to have a look, you can also give your amendments to me. Point of order, 1 minute. Mr. Aulokin? Yes, I want to raise a point of order. I want to revoke at 21H of a House rule to extend the time of scrutiny of the bill. There are two reasons why I want to do this. First of all, many members went to the West Kowloon station for an inspection. But I understand that not all of them have returned. Some members have not yet completed their inspection at West Kowloon station, so that's reason number one. Second, the officials have either not responded to our questions or not responded to our questions with answers satisfactorily, and our inspections was not comprehensive. They did not allow us to go to some areas. Mr. Quatermo, why support Mr. Aulokin? This morning we went to inspect at the station. It was just like last time. We were treated like tourists. We went there for an inspection. We'd like to know the boundary of the mainland port area. We have discussed the bill for so long. It's about collocation. It's about where the boundary of the MPA is drawn. And now Mr. Zhu Hoitik has voluntarily become a hostage at the West Kowloon station. Because once this bill is passed, then however much you beg and besiege, you're not going to be allowed to the mainland port area in the future. Well, I've heard the two members. Cross six. Last time five members asked questions, there are six. Six members are in the queue. Mr. Ngao, it's not your turn to speak. The six members are Dr. Helena Wong, Mr. Chen Chi-Chun, Mr. Wu Chi-Wai, Dr. Cheng Chung-Tai, Ms. Claudia Mo, and Dr. Fernando Zhang. Mr. Wen, point of order? Well, I have a simple point to make. Cross 6 is really about the inspection that we did today. Then you can ask your questions. We have Dr. Helena Wong, and then we also have Mr. Charles Smock. Mr. Charles Smock, when can the administration respond to our questions, questions in writing? It's not yet responded to. Can I have a quick reply? from the officials. We have just received these. Please read it and raise questions after you have digested the content. Last member to raise a point of order. Dr. Kwakake, I was not there this morning, but the secretary should explain why this so-called inspection will not allow members to check important locations, because this will help us scrutinizing Article 6 to 8. I think the secretary may wish to give an account of to the members' concern, to respond to members' concern on another occasion. Dr. Helena Wong, I hope Mr. Frank Chan would arrange for a visit to the West Kowloon Station so that we can see where the boundary is drawn. On cross 6, I hope I can get some short answers, and that is within B2, B3, B4, are advertisements allowed on those levels? Will MTRC allow advertisements in the MPF, MPA? Thank you, Madam Chair. Whether the MPA would accept advertisement is something between the MPA operators and the MPA. So you don't know. The MPA is managed under the relevant mainland laws, so it would be managed by the MPA. In other words, it's not up to the MTRC. Secretary, would you please ask the mainland officials responsible for this MPA? Can election campaign advertisements, election advertisements, or political advertisements be allowed? The jurisdiction is the mainland's jurisdiction. So I have no obligation to follow up the matters on behalf of the mainland authorities. Well, at present, candidates for the various elections can put up advertisements on MTR stations. Whether you are from, they are from the pro-establishment camp or from the pan-democratic camp, but in the future, would they only allow advertisements from pro-establishment camp candidates? And also, what if the advertisements would the advertisement costs be counted towards the election expenses? And also, in the train compartment, when they leave the station and when they are not in operation, they would fall under the Hong Kong jurisdictions. So would the advertisement costs be counted partially? The MPA is managed by the mainland authorities. I have nothing to supplement. Would you tell the relevant mainland officials that we need to uphold the fairness of elections? Mr. Chen Chi-Chin is not here. Do we have Mr. Chen Chi-Chin with us? No. Dr. Zheng Chong-Tai, 3 minutes. Thank you. Madam Chair, I'm talking about Cross 6, C536 for a Chinese version, on reserve matters. The Bar Association has raised some questions about reserve matters, but so far no satisfactory answer has been given to those questions. Turn on cross 6. It's the 12th of March, 2016. You mentioned reserve matters. So part of the West Kowloon's XRL station would be marked, would be designated as an AMPA. But how can you be sure that the MPA will be then subject to the jurisdiction of the mainland, of the mainland legal system? And the Bar Association has also said that the deeming provision is against the principle of one country, two system, and against the basic law. So why, in designating an MPA, the constitution of the MPRC and the national laws of PRC that would be applicable as a result of the destination? Can you respond succinctly to this deeming provision, to this criticism of the Bar Association on cross 6, the deeming provision? Mr. Lai, the government is of the view that the designation of the MPA is in conformity with the basic law, and we have explained to this council a number of times. I will ask if Mr. Mui has anything to add here. Mr. Mui, thank you, Dr. Chang. I think Dr. Chang is referring to the Bar Association's paper dated the 12th of March, and there are concerns on cross 6. And we have explained previously that the Article 18 of Basic Laws is about the general prohibition of the general application of mainland laws in the SAR. So now through cross 6, we deal with the question, the issue of applicability and jurisdiction. This is in line with Article 18.
Mr. Andrew Wen. So I saw, I was quite surprised that Dr. Helen Wong asked the question, because you are about involving changing the borders. It is ridiculous, because this bill is preposterous itself. Last time I asked the secretary, would rubbish concepts come with rubbish replies? So on same with the same comments, you claim that the MPA is to be regarded as an area outside Hong Kong. So I'm giving a perfunctory reply. So does that mean the rubbish collected from each compartment will be processed and supervised to prevent smuggling of contraband such as gold, drugs, and firearms? This is a major loophole. And looking at this clause, the cooperation agreement claims that there will be a respective service contract to on these respective port areas. So why can't we do that? Besides, for the discarded items outside the compartments, how would it be dealt with? Is it like you said, they will be passed on to local for local handling? We've asked the question many times. And this is not a question on compartments. So let me try to explain once again. And Mr. Al had replied quite clearly. In the West Kowloon Station, all the rubbish and the goods and the entry and pass elements, we go through the inspection of the respective enforcement agencies. So there are rubbish on the compartments. Upon arrival at the West Kowloon Station, the Hong Kong side staff will be responsible for the collection and the transport. And when passing the goods and rubbish passageway, they'll be subject to a safety risk inspection to prevent any illegal behavior. So a certain extent where necessary and so on. So what is the standard procedure? Can you tell us? I see it's a problem there. So even for the existing legislation, for the transport of waste and rubbish, they're regulated by law. So are you following existing legislation, or you are drafting new measure legislation? That is the procedure of handling rubbish and cargo. And for all our BCPs, for example, airport and train stations, and even our land control points, they take a similar manner. This is a security question. I think this is a concept. We don't know, it's not been handled by the Chinese border control. That I'm worried about this loophole. Dr. Kiki Kwok, I would like to give more time, Frank Chance, to explain why we have such a bad arrangement. And for the members to inspect the West Kowloon Station and to look at the vital facilities and passageways are not allowed to for entry. I want to ask about the provisions. So we should be focusing on the on the bill. So provisions is quite clear. For example, on the Paris 7 cooperation agreement on the mainland station authorities. So for those mainland station authorities, we usually think that there could be the CIQ authorities. There could be other forceful and agencies. And this morning, our colleagues visited the Kowloon Station and want to look at the station arrangements of the mainland authorities to see if there are other, for example, armory room and so on. That should be public knowledge, unless there is a secret, for example, like a custody detention room, interrogation room, and so on. So this is paid for by the Hong Kong public. All the border crossing facilities would be provided for Hong Kong to China. That would not open to members. Oh well, is that for the use of the mainland station authorities, including the strong enforcement agents, strong agency departments, and all the transport infrastructure around the world play an important role in the local economy and transport. And in the past, the chair attacks with folk targeting these heavily commuted areas. So whereas safety and security concern with the layout and the facilities would not allow the unnecessary staff to visit, nor as to leak the specific arrangements in order to compromise the security arrangements. Would that be an armory room or detention facilities? And so that for anyone not welcomed and not on a rookie law for provocation, there will be a lock up there. Any supplement on that? Thanks to Dr. Kwok's question, we have nothing to add to this question. On the layout plan, there are a lot of blank spaces. What kind of facilities are there? Which kind of mainland authorities will be stationed there? Dr. Kwok's administration already explained that first critical facilities. These are security facilities. Why not let the Secretary Bureau to handle that? Rebecca Poon. According to the Paris 6 of the Cooperation Agreement, that the mainland station authorities are limited to CIQ and the in which there will be a station fulfill the discharge duties in the MPA and will not enforce the law outside of MPA and have no jurisdiction outside. A priest asked for another round. I must tell the whole public that today's visit was meaningless. This is a phony visit. So this morning, Frank Chan seemed to have some chit-chat with us, and he left shortly afterwards. And let's check out the boundary of the MPA. So because it's not necessary in the not out of scope of this bill's provisions. So what is today's visit for? What we want to see that we're not allowed to see, and then while we scrutinize Clause 6, why do we want to look at the boundary? Because Clause 6 is talking about the laws and jurisdiction of the mainland port area. But today, have we managed to see the boundary of the MPA? This morning visit is a farce. Mr. Chan, please don't laugh. I found you miserable. This is not the proper attitude for a secretary. I simply cannot offer my respect to the secretary. Look at the so today, on scrutinizing Clause 6, they wouldn't allow to see the fire escape. But I noticed one thing that on the passageway to the MPA, there will be shops constructed, and they have yet to put up the boundary for the shops, and yet at the back we have the fire escape, and further back will be the mainland MPA boundary. So we can't conduct a study like this. How we see the shops layout and the fire escape as and the smoke fireproof doors. So how do we see that they are joined to the mainland port area? So as we can see this morning, the whole visit is meaningless. And now that for this bill, the administration responses, it not directly responds to the members and the public concern. And you claim that it is unnecessary or out of scope from the of the Clause 6. So how is this scrutiny of the bound, we had nothing to do with Clause 6. So we have 211 fire escape doors, there's no account for it. And fire escape, how would they be controlled? And there's no account of it. I just found this out, that the shops will be adjoining to the fire escape. Your time is up, Mr. Ao. Mr. Chen, do you have anything to add? Nothing. Next, Mr. Kenneth Leung. Let the line finish. I have to cut him off. Mr. Leung, please ask away. So for Clause 6, just follow up on Dr. Helen's one question on the advertisement signboards. So I have a general question. I would like to know that inside the MPA, will there be any commercial revenues such as advertisement? For the MPA, if the walls or the spaces will be leaded as shops, I don't see how the agreement have provided for this space. So what if it ran out the advertisement or even allow the mainland authorities to create revenue inside MPA to subdivide into shops? So let's say I have a space of 100 to 200 meters, so I would have this mini shops that would be subleased for rental revenue. So I don't see any specific provision in this agreement in whether any space of the MPA can be subdivided for commercial purposes. If so, and how you calculate the revenue, and will some revenue be returned to the MTR or the HUD government, or is it explicitly prohibited? Can the secretary answer that? So for the cooperation agreement, do we only allow commercial activity like these? So I heard from Mr. Leung that whether there will be advertisement space, advertising space offered by the mainland station authorities, because the building is managed by the MTRCL, offered for the advertising space, well, besides the advertising space, they have this corner that could be, I want to have set up some corner shops and so on for the vacant space. As regards for the operation of the Hong Kong port area, we can elaborate on. For the operation at the MPA, it very much depends on the corresponding unit. Today, I cannot answer for them on their behalf. So therefore, it's impossible to say that in case of having commerciativity or selling advertisement spaces, whether there will be a split revenue arrangement, that we can answer for them. But currently, this is not covered in the corporate group agreement because it's very vague at this point. Secretary, in our cooperation agreement or with the central government or the Guangdong government, would any commercial activity allowed in the MPA? As far as I know, the MPA has no shops. So let's say they could have some walls used to display items, or whether they can charge money for that. The mainland authorities will have to make up their own decision. Mr. Poche, let's go back to the real question for Clause 6. So in theory, it mentioned the reserve and the reserved matters. And on the definition of reserve and non-reserved matters, it only I'll refer back to the schedule of the Article 3 and 4 and 7 of the corporation agreement. So looking at the definition for Article 4 is not defined. It was only by exception. So anything that's not 3 to 7 will be governed by 4. However, 3 and 7, so looking at Schedule 1, because it's just direct copying from the corporation agreement. So therefore, the formatting and the delivery and the definition is unlike other bills where it was clear. I found this quite jumbled.
There are seven areas: right to build, right to construct, service concession, construction work, or operation agreement, right to assets and to facilities. It's very difficult to read. I think maybe the government would just like to copy what's in the cooperation agreement, but that means that people reading the bill will find it difficult to comprehend. Is there something you can do to improve the drafting? Mr. Pang? Mr. Lai? Thank you for your question, Mr. Chair. With regard to Clause 3 and Clause 7, we use general terms. These terms are references to principles. So our concern is whether those terms are clear to the MPA operators. And our decision is that it's clear. It's a very limited area. The MPA is limited in area. So for Article 3 and Article 7, we are talking about people doing the maintenance and repair. So for them, the guidance provided in 3 and 7 is already very clear. And that is, in simple terms, that they should do what Hong Kong is doing when they are in the MPA. Mr. Charles Small, when a member asks questions about advertisements, I think we should look at the principles. Maybe the secretary cannot answer now since you did not look into these principles. Can you renegotiate the agreement? And what are the principles that you would like to comply with? If this is regarded as an area leased to the mainland, so you as the lessor, you can impose certain conditions. You may wish to state that you want to see certain principles complied with. Today we saw some of the facilities in the MPA, including the counters for immigration. But is it that they can do the refurbishment any way they like? Are they going to transport the materials needed to them? Are they going to employ mainland workers to do the work? I saw some monitors there. It seems that they are already linked up with computers, maybe not with the mainland computer system. But one of the mons, this show the window image. So who should be responsible for what? It seems to me that we are not very clear about this. What are ours and what are theirs? You have so many things already built there. So can you clarify the matter? Under the cooperation agreement 272 states very clearly that the design, repair, maintenance will be done by the mainland organizations stationed there. Apart from facilities needed for the performance of the duties. So the monitors, the computer, and the renovation and so on and so forth will be handled under Hong Kong laws. They have to install their own programs. We'll provide the computers. Do they trust our computers? They need to pay for the computers. They would deal directly with their contractors. If they use the service of a Hong Kong contractor, they would have to pay. They can opt for mainland contractors? No, because the Hong Kong laws will be applicable. And we are talking about the immigration counters there. Were dedicated. Apart from a dedicated equipment for the purpose of discharging the duties, others we would have to apply Hong Kong law. Let's say the immigration or mainland immigration officer will be using a computer. Would the computer be provided by Hong Kong side? If they would have their own computers, but the display panel is another thing. Well, I've given you more time to clarify this particular point. Ms. Guardiamo, second round. I've heard from Mr. Lai. Saying that the MPA cannot be regarded as an ordinary place in Hong Kong. The definition of mainland, is there any part of the mainland which is not Hong Kong? And now within Hong Kong, you have a place which is regarded as mainland. And we'll talk about laws and jurisdiction in mainland port area, this morning's inspection was supposed to be very much relevant, but we were not allowed to look at the entire boundary. You have to be fair. We wanted to see a part of that boundary, and you said it's a construction site, and you suggested that there may be a safety issue. And then you say that there's no need to see what's inside. So we are part of the group of people who don't need to see it. But you are saying that very easily the computer system, the security system, can be compromised. So that's speaking Chinese in an English manner. You should have said that it may be damaged, it may be destroyed. You say there's no need for us to see it. Are you saying that we are irrelevant? We are people who are not concerned, who are not relevant to the case? Or you're concerned about something may be compromised. But after this bill is passed, then there will be no way you will allow us to inspect, however many times we ask. I think it's a question about the inspection. Thank you, Ms. Mo. The government's team's stance is that the layout and of security installations are made to take care of the situation at ground. We have to keep it confidential so that when the time comes, they should be able to fulfill their functions. Mr. Chen Jiqun, may I ask the government to respond to my questions? At long last, after 3 weeks, I received a reply from the government. It said that the commencement day is the day of operation. The MPA will only come under mainland jurisdiction after the commencement of the enacted bill. But you don't have a date for the commissioning of the XRL. It's just set to be September. If it's not September, then the chairperson would not have asked us to rush so much in scrutinizing the bill. You don't know the exact date of the commissioning or the start of the operation. You said that the commencement day can be a little bit earlier than the operational day. Theoretically, you can commence the new ordinance, but the secretary would not like to do this. So it may be 3 days or 6 days before the operation. You are saying that we are in such a rush, but you have no further information about the commencement of operation. Are we going to commence the operation of the XRL as scheduled? We want to reduce the gap between the commencement date of the new ordinance and the actual commissioning of the XRL would be as short as possible. we have already indicated to our mainland counterparts they would like to get some time for preparation. Mr. Chan asked whether it would be 1 week or whatever period. We'd like to compress the time taken, shorten the time taken between the 2 days so as to reduce worries on the part of people. We're in communication with the mainland authorities. And if you want to know exactly the number of days for that particular window or gap, I'll let you know as soon as we have the information. Mr. Alvin Young, in the future, there may be commercial activities in the mainland port area. It's not mentioned in the agreement. The MPA is a large area. If in the future, for commercial reasons, they would like to allow commercial activities to be conducted, do they have to consult us? Or is it because this is an MPA, they can decide to do anything without the need to seek our consent? In the cooperation agreement, the MPA is provided for co-location so that the relevant ICQ functions can be fulfilled. So we do not provide for the prospect of commercial activities. But MTRC will also be servicing the MPA. And I don't know whether under that arrangement they will be doing this. We know that the people working in the mainland port area will need to have meals. There must be some arrangements for them to have lunch or dinner, and whether this will be done under some sort of commercial arrangement, I'm not sure. Well, I'm interested in the latter part of the Secretary's reply. According to the agreement, mainland government may not carry out commercial activities there. I can understand that. But if the MTRC wants to carry out some commercial activities in the MPA, there is such a possibility. The MTRC also offer shop spaces in their stations. If in the future, if they want to operate a duty-free service, do they need to seek approval from certain parties, or is it really up to them to decide?
So for the laws and jurisdiction of the MPA, it's decided by the mainland. And in different occasions, we mentioned that there have been no space reserved for shops in the MPA. Which, Madam Chair, allow me to ask further, can MTRCL allow to set up shops in the MPA? Can you clarify that, Secretary? I said just now and earlier, and there were no reserves space for shops in the MPA. So the provision of meals will be regarded as a commercial activities. It depends on the eventual arrangement for the meal provisions for the mainland station authority personnel. Madam Chair, I'd like to follow up on Mr. Ray Chan's question on the letter given to Ray Chan by the administration, or written by Mr. Ray Chan. So on the second page mentioned, after the completion of installation, the mainland station authority personnel will conduct a testing to ensure that the facilities are functioning properly. And They will be conducted in strict accordance with the local requirements. So how can you prove that there will be a rigorous testing? Second question, if not able to meet the Hong Kong legal requirements, what it should do? Any mechanism to ensure that it will comply with the local legal requirements? If eventually it failed to do so, what will you do? Is there such a mechanism in place to deal with such issues? Thank you, Mr. Leung. On the equipment or the system, we need to adhere to Hong Kong regulations. For example, a fire safety system, and Hong Kong had a very strict inspection acceptance regime, and the fire service department also had their own as standard and guidelines. So that will be the sense of rigorous. If not able to pass the inspection or meet the standards, the relevant system operator must conduct rectification in accordance with Hong Kong laws. And without rectification, they may have to suspend or not able to commission the space. This demonstrate the high standards for the inspection acceptance of facilities in Hong Kong. Even though there will be a rigorous test and stringent testing, how stringent is that? Will the colleagues be able to do their job so stringently? Can you inspire confidence in the Hong Kong public that can make sure that it's fair and transparent? So ensure that not up to standard, you will disclose where areas fall short, so that the public will know where it would fall short, and hence it could not proceed further. Will you make such announcements? So if you're being so cozy with each other, then we have no idea. Can you ensure the whole process is fair and transparent? Undersecretary of Security, Mr. Ao. In the West Kowloon Station, this is a railway project, and they'll be subjected to the Safety and Security Coordination Committee, and the chairman of this committee is a representative of the Railway Division and the EMSD, with FSD, HAPF, and the Buildings Department and the House Department reps. And in this committee, there were checked and approved on the works and make sure it complied with security and safety requirements. For any incidents, the electrical can summons the committee members to give an account. Can you disclose the testing data so that the public can tell whether it's compliant or not? So I know what the composition of this committee is. Can you enhance the transparency? Mr. Al, anything supplement? Can you prove, for example, the data, the testing and inspection data, can you disclose them? So after validating the safety, would it ever disclose their findings? Have this been done before? Oh, Mr. Chan? And the data and evidence collected by the enforcement actions by the agencies, well, they are obtained in the course of enforcement. So we usually would not make the data public. Mr. Justin Lam. Now that part of the West Kowloon Station will be designated as the MPA, and it stayed within Hong Kong, however, jurisdiction has been passed on to the mainland authorities. And for the International Convention, as where Hong Kong is a signatory, can it be applied? Can those be applied to the MPA, Mr. Mui? as for the international treaties applicable to Hong Kong in terms of their applicability in the MPA, and since it's a very small space, our assessment is that there would not have major problems. If such need arises, the Hong Kong government to follow up with the central government authorities, including the Foreign Ministry Office, Representative Office in Hong Kong. Talking about the treaties Hong Kong signed with different nations, are they still valid in the MPA? Thank you, Mr. Lam's question. On the applicability of treaties, usually we look at it at two levels. On the international treaties level, that after the treaty has been signed between a nation or a region for where Hong Kong SAR is a signatory, the treaty will still be valid. And then another level that since this treaty are applied through local legislation, so I believe that Mr. Just Lam's fall on the first level. So after the treaty has this whole valid without any amendment, it will continue to be in force. And whereas the treaty signed between Hong Kong and different nations is concerned, and Hong Kong is obligated to fulfill the obligations, whether through the central government or through itself, it must fulfill the treaty obligations in the MPA. Am I correct? Thank you for Mr. Lam's question. So Mr. Lam's understanding is correct. I got it. So our assessment is that the impact will be small. If the mainland failed to fulfill these treaty obligations, or if not a party to the treaty, then what will you do? Even though the Hong Kong government have requested the central for government to fulfill the obligation under the treaty, and yet they refuse. And like I said in my response, because the MPA made up a small space, our assessment is that and on the possibility of this arisen will be quite slim. If necessary, the Hong Kong government will make corresponding arrangements with the central government. I just say it's not a matter of size. However, Mr. Mui had already gave you a reply for any potential issues you would negotiate with the foreign ministry. Next, Dr. Fernandez Chung, and you can stay for the next round. Just now, you're asking it to be to respect the secretary. However, it's not reciprocated respect. In his early response, he claims that these are important securities, important facilities, and due to security grounds, that would not let unnecessary people to visit the place. We are scrutinizing the bill that this we are designating a space called the MPA in this bill, and even the coordinates of the MPA have been very detailed. For us to scrutinize this bill to fulfill our role under the basic law, we need to see unseen the actual boundary. And yet the secretary replied saying that we are unnecessary people. That said Article 64, the Hong Kong government will need to be accountable to the Electoral Council. So we're scrutinizing this bill. There's a need for us to look at the boundary of the MPA. Madam Chair, please add a response. Why electoral members considered irrelevant people. Mr. Eddie Chu is still at the West Kowloon Station. Is he considered irrelevant? So let the secretary explain what do you mean by irrelevant. So the word redundant, or bupiu in Chinese, was the word raised by Mr. Claudio Mo. I don't recall if I said this. The meaning of what I said is the backed up areas and the areas of where security is concerned had to do with security and safe and risk layout. It is have a comprehensive security considerations. So I'll have Mr. Al to supplement. So that's why we are concerned about the security. So this is outside the purview of the electrical members. And so do we take a need to know, do we shown to the on a need-to-know basis. In our early reply to the electrical members, including the response to the electrical advisor on March 14 and February 22, on the passageways and the escalators of the doors connecting the mainland and Hong Kong port areas, our view is that we further disclose all the locations of the doors and so on. They're unnecessarily increase their security risk.
Yeah.
Well, this is an important infrastructure. It's going to be designated as such when it is up and running. If we declare the layout plans in detail, we are not asking you to publish the layout. When we went there, you asked us not to bring our mobile phones in. We agreed. We were there to inspect the ICQ facilities. We are now in the legislative process. Your time is up. Dr. Chiang Chong Tai. I want to ask a question about Schedule 1, Article 7. There's some reference to the building and certain facility, but there's no mention of telecommunication. Can I confirm that within the MPA there is telecommunication service, or people can use the internet and there's a hi-fi? Secretary, travelers within the MPA can have access to the internet with roaming service. Can they use the service provided by local ISP for internet service, or is it that he will have to use a data roaming service? This is not mentioned in the articles. Would the internet access be restricted to Wi-Fi service only? I think Mr. Michael Tin asked the same question. Maybe you can answer the question again. There is a telecommunication network serving the MPA. If you use a telephone SIM card, of course you can have access to internet. Of course, if they provide Wi-Fi service, of course you can do the same through Wi-Fi. In terms of telecommunication, there is an overlapping there in jurisdiction. Under Schedule 1, well, you have to apply the Hong Kong law for certain matters, but that does not include telecommunications. But give me a minute, Chairman. Someone may have breached the internet safety laws of PLC, and then the mainland authorities can ask ISP is to provide certain information. Can the mainland authorities ask local ISPs for information in that area? Well, it was discussed last time. Let me repeat. If we are talking about the MPA, if a traveler is in breach of any law, we would be handling the case under mainland laws, national laws. Last time, a member raised a hypothetical situation. If someone disseminates some information within the MPA, and the mainland law enforcement agency wants the Hong Kong ISP to provide information on the client, but as I said, the ISP has to operate its business in accordance with Hong Kong laws. So, the ISP provider should respect privacy of his client. But this has been carved out as belonging to
We are short of three members.
Mr. Tan, why did you ask Mr. Kwok to leave? There's a meeting next door.
够人啦！
We have a quorum. Please be seated. Meeting is now resumed. Mr. Jeremy Tam. First round, 3 minutes. The bell is still sounding. Do we have a quorum? Yes, yes. Well, the bells are for the AGLS panel meeting.
譚議員，請你開始。
我想問咧，關於咧，即係因為主席你話咧，如果上次冇提
，Madam Chair, you said that new points not mentioned last time can be raised now. I want to talk about Shek Kong. According to the reply, you are going to rely on Cap 556 bylaws to regulate the operation of Shek Kong.Are you relying on 28E in the bylaws in the setting the restricted area? Thank you. It's back to Shek Kong, but it's a new point according to Mr. Tam. Are you going to regulate your rely on 28E for echo? Ms. Poon?Ms. Pun? We are considering whether we should invoke 28D in setting the restricted area. So this is still under consideration. We are about to pass the bill. And you are still considering this?Are you...kidding me? You're still considering whether you want to invoke 28E? We would complete this, we would give an indication sometime before the commissioning of XRL. Why do you have to do this before commissioning of XRL? Why haven't you make a decision first before you table the bill? Then there's no way I can tell whether it's 28E, because Hong Hum, in Hong Hum, it's not 28E. Mr. Lam? Mr. Andy Lam? Any depot is a railway premise, which is not accessible by ordinary people.Then according to railways bylaw, it's some place not accessible by the public. Unauthorized entry is a violation of the bylaw and is subject to a fine of $5,000. So my question is that the provision for setting up the restricted area? Well, actually, some area of railway...depot will be designated as a restricted area for safety concern. This is the fourth or fifth time that I've asked this. Is it 28E? Mr. Andy Lam, we are considering the scope, the area to be designated. As I've said, normally the tracks will be part of the restricted area.But for this Shek Kong, the stapling sidings, we have to consider the area to be designated. So you don't know which part of Shek Kong would be designated as a restricted area. How can you still be considering this?But this has got nothing to do with the public because the entire...Shek Kong stapling sidings is not accessible by the public. Well, are you saying that because it's out of bounds to the public, you don't have to explain to this council? Mr. Gary Fang, first round. Secretary, we are scrutinizing the cross-six, part one of the bill. We're seeing that for an area within Hong Kong, which will become a mainland port area once the bill is enacted. That's why we went there to take a look at the station. Why do you say that there's no need for legislator to know, to see? We're not talking about a normal fire exit or fire escape, because after entering the door, it's another area, it's the mainland port area. We make it clear that we would like to see it. What are you hiding, Secretary? So that you do not want legislator to do the inspection that we want. What are you hiding? Well, this is a question about the inspection. Secretary, first of all, the SAR government has got nothing to hide, and we have reiterated a number of times that we need to ensure safety and security of our important facilities. We don't want to affect the security of our facilities. We are not asking you to make public the design layout and the detailed plan. We just wanted to see how it would be managed and operated. Are you saying that legislators are dangerous people? And if we enter that location, which will soon to be designated as the mainland port area, that would pose a security problem? Mr. Ngao. Thank you, Madam Chair. I thank Mr. Fang for his question. And I'll reply to Ms. Tanya Chan's questions dated the 14th of March. We mentioned some doors, some fire emergency exits. Some are within the Hong Kong port area, which have nothing to do with mainland port area or cross six. In the same letter, we mentioned there were 221 emergency rooms, fire exits in the MPA.
211 fireproof door and fire escape doors. So I'll be the commissioning of the port area still be locked securely, and the Hong Kong Authority of the management of this store, there will be under CCTV surveillance with alarm and video recording. So they have to pass through the control room, and staff cannot able to open or access them. Only in emergency situations that these doors will be opened for evacuation. Next, Mr. Chang Hang Ben. And no matter how much time been provided for this scrutiny, so Mr. Kerry Fan asked to ring the corn bell, and everyone walked out. So they hope to sit down for a meeting and then walk out and hope that the meeting will be aborted. So which way does it agreed on? So if the meeting aborted, they know the scrutiny. So the purpose is not to scrutinize the bill, rather to obstruct the scrutiny, for which I strongly condemn them. And all the design plans, so the matters of high security, the layout plans should not be for viewing and casually. So if you let if this be leaked to the public, the loopholes will be discovered. Therefore, I don't want the public to know that the door locations in this station. Otherwise, there will be risk. So at the last visit, and somebody chose them to sign up and complained that they don't get the chance. And then when they arrived and they came to stage a protest and claimed the insufficient time, not inspect close enough because they were staging a protest and claimed they could not access a lot of places. There's no way to meet the needs of everyone, that because their aim is simply to procrastinate. I hope that you can be decisive in handling the bill. The public had hoped for the early commissioning of the bill. Mr. Yu Shuing, any questions on country provisions? I'd like to ask on the laws and jurisdiction for the MPA. So for the, I have a question on insurance. The now that it falls within two different jurisdictions, will be purchase their insurance in accordance with their own conditions. Is there any consensus on this? And the plans have been pretty clear on the delineation of the mainland and the Hong Kong port area. And for the, so there will be further adjustment in the operations. So what is the procedures for making such adjustments? Would it be complicated, or it can be done through legislation? Who will take the question, Mr. Frank Chan, or thank you, Mr. Yu. So I'm not an expert in insurance. I believe that in different jurisdictions, they may not have the same demand on insurance. So it depends whether the insurance sector can come up with a policy that can meet two jurisdictions. And for the travel insurance, that's fairly commonplace. Depends on which type of insurance Mr. Yu is referring to. So there might be, need to be changes made to collocation arrangements. Of course, they can, and changes can be done unilaterally. So where there are shortcomings, then both sides can negotiate which consensus in signing supplementary agreement. And the cooperation agreement. We need to, after the amendment, we need to obtain approval from the central government. So you can't be amended quite casually. So we talk about more than insurance, for example, third-party liability insurance and so on. And for most tourists and passengers, they know that whatever happened to them, they'll be subjected to the same protection, or that their coverage in the MPA and would differ from that in the Hong Kong port area. I think we need to reach a consensus on this. So we have one country, two system. However, on this matter, we need to make this clear to the passengers. I'll have Mr. Lai, Dominic Lai. This is a mainland port area. So they have to comply with the adhere to mainland laws. So if after mainland law have been enforcing in the MPA, there will be impacting the insurance sector. Mr. Andrew Wen. So I'm going to follow on my own question. For Mr. Lam, Justin Lam asked a real important question which the administration gave a poor response. So the response shows that highlighted the ridiculousness of the collocation spell. So you're neither fish or fowl. On one hand, you claim that in the provisions that the MPA would be regarded as an area lying outside Hong Kong but lying within the mainland. However, for international treaties, the Hong Kong would still need to discharge its obligations. As you know, that Hong Kong is a signatory to some treaties, but while the mainland is not, there are dozens of them. We cannot delegate it to the central government to handle that for us. So for some treaties, some they have been signed by China, but it is condemned. For example, the Convention Against Torture. So if there is a shortfall in the enforcement, and if somebody launch illegal complaints, can the Hong Kong court take the case? And Mr. Mui, like I respond to Mr. Lam, on the applicability of treaties. And since it made only a small area, and our assessment was that for any potential issues or on this, the possibility will be small. If such thing arises, I just said earlier that this Hong Kong government can because this cannot be handled such way. Also, I just mentioned torture. So for the past 6 years, China have been condemned for the lack of enforcement of, for the convention on torture. So it would still happen in a small area. It would only take a room, or maybe just a bathroom, or a small room. He haven't quite answered my question, Mr. Ao. So we've asked different kind of questions all along. For example, for Mr. Wen's question, have already took two members to ask the same question. For both of them, they're not able to provide a satisfactory answer. So there's no way for me to accept Mr. Chen Hanbei as statements. So either we meet scrutinizing the bill or going on DDP, said the government representatives have not been to provide a correct or satisfactory answer. Mr. Al, please raise your question. Okay, I'll go into it. I noticed on the reserved matters, as mentioned in clause for 5, some of them Hong Kong will fall, and we have a jurisdiction. And for the providers, legislation, and this for is and so can you set an example of a accept with agreement on reserved matters part number 5. We've had to agree. So, Article 7, no, item number 5. Unless by parties by agreement indicated otherwise. The meaning of indicated otherwise is not a civil nature than where the Hong Kong laws does not apply. Can you give us some examples? And what sort of agreement will let indicate otherwise, that which are both parties will deliver the opposite meaning, that in this contract the Hong Kong law is not applicable? So if the contract is stated the main laws will apply, and that will give the effect of using main law. So on the first round, I've asked whether advertisement will be allowed in the MPA. We have to deal with the operations and the service rights and the supervision. And Article 6, should be viewed along with Article 3 in the schedule. And I asked it whether political advertisement will be allowed in the MPA. And Mr. Frank Chan claimed it would to be decided by the mainland. And for the Article 3 of the cooperation agreement, that establishment of the mainland port area does not affect the construction rights related to performance and construction work, service concession, and cooperation and regulation of the Hong Kong section of the express rail link. So the service concession, operation, and missions will still remain with the Hong Kong side. So I think you're referring to the Article 3 of the cooperation agreement. The establishment of the MPA does not affect the Hong Kong section construction and operation. So we talk about the operations. That's why I'm asking that inside MPA for level B2, 3, and 4, including inside the compartments, whether we allow advertising revenue or commercial activities, and the space could be leased out for commercial purposes or conduct charities or political activities. Would that fall within an operation and a service concession? Would the MPA would not, so that would not have to say in its operations? For the, if the operations that were handled by the MTCR, they would not be affected. So the MTCR would always, for example, in the escalators or on compartments, that any candidates will be allowed to politically answer. So it is something that can this MTRCL decide by itself, or they have to consult the mainland. If Hong Kong is operating with, in accordance with Hong Kong laws, and what have been allowed it will remain. So there will be no screening advertisement in the mainland port area. Please answer that question. Anything to add, Secretary? Nothing. Next, Mr. Wu Chi-wai, first round. Just then, I heard the legal advice, the government counsel. So the event of dispute, the likelihood is quite small. I believe that you'll be, can you provide us with a checklist, but how many international treaties we are party to? There will be a differential treatment on Hong Kong and China. So if both are the signatories, and given treatment, can you provide us, set up in a table? So for a small size of the mainland port area, that such problems will not arise, can you provide us with a checklist, Mr. Mui? So as signatory, thank you, Mr. Wu's question. As for the treaties already enforced in the Hong Kong, the government has such information. And for the question raised by Mr. Justin Lam, and some of the treaties or conventions that Hong Kong and China are both members, and that information we don't have. So therefore, we have no way to provide this information. Can the legal advisors speak on this? Or can the legal advisor collect such information for us? Legal advisor, can you provide such information in due course? So members could first request the government to provide such information. So if the government can provide them, so in view of resources, the ministry claimed they can't provide them. So you applied, and such likelihood is small. So whatever likelihood, you still have to submit a document to let me decide. So because the size is small, therefore there will be no potential issues. Do you have to consult the foreign ministry? So the request made by Mr. Wu, we can look into it to see it can be fulfilled. Madam Chair, this is a fact. Why couldn't he provide us information? So let him look into whether it can be done. So if you can't do it, give us a document anyway and explain. Please submit the document later. Second round.
謝謝主席, 我想問回呢, 就是啦,
Clause 6, bracket 1, is a deeming provision. Except for reserve matters, the MPA is to be regarded as an area lying outside Hong Kong but lying within the mainland. That's why it would not affect the boundary of the SAR, Hong Kong SAR. That's what I heard last time. So it's a bracket 2. They are really superfluous. If someone moves an amendment to delete bracket 2, the clarity of bracket 1 would not be affected? Is that clarity of bracket 1 would not be affected? Who would answer this question? Thank you, Mr. Chen. The first subclause is a deeming provision for two purposes, and the subclause 2 is to confirm that section 1 will not affect the boundary of the administrative division of the Hong Kong SAR for the avoidance of doubt and disputes. Well, if someone takes a bracket 2 away, would the bracket 1 be affected? Would the objective of bracket 1 be affected? Well, in the MPCSC's decision, it mentions that boundary of the Hong Kong SAR would not be affected. So bracket 2 is here to reflect the content of the MPCSC decision. Well, sometimes we want to have more. You will say that's for clarity's sake. You say there's no need. And now you want to have subclause 2 for clarity, for more clarity. So what are the criteria in which to adopt? Mr. Lam Chuk Ting, Secretary, when we talk to the mainland authorities, did you tell the mainland authorities that our international treaty obligation would continue to apply in the MPA? Has the mainland agreed to this? Did you talk to the mainland authorities? I would like to ask Mr. Mui, the Deputy Solicitor General, to say something on the applicability of international treaties. The SAR government did talk to the government, to the CPG. Did you tell them in the MPA, Hong Kong will remain a signatory to those international treaties and will be under an obligation to fulfill those obligations? Let me first of all clarify a point. The applicability of these treaties. Well, we are not a signatory. Well, not a signatory. What about a party to the international conventions and treaties? Did the mainland agree to this? Well, the SAR government did talk to the mainland authorities about our obligations. Has they agreed? Do they agree that we in the MPA that we would continue to fulfill our obligations in the MPA? Just say agreed or not agreed. No need to go round in circle. Well, the SAR government, as I've said, has communicated to the mainland, and our assessment is that the chances of having problems will be slim. How can you do this? We're talking about international conventions and treaties. Are you saying that if the chance is low, then it won't happen? Please, order, please. Please don't shout. I think Mr. Mui has said that there was a certain discussions, and the assessment is that the chances of having problems are low. Maybe I can supplement that in respect of this question raised by Mr. Lam. As I've said, we have talked to the CPG over the matter. We are of the view that the chances of having problems are very small. And if necessary, the CPG would handle the matter appropriately under its power to handle foreign relations for Hong Kong. And I want to talk about the scope of the laws of the mainland. And the government has said that we cannot be specific that which laws of the mainland would be applicable in handling ICQ. So is my understanding correct that the laws of the mainland would cover laws not directly related to ICQ? So if there are new laws enacted in the law or laws amended in the mainland, would they be directly and immediately applicable to the MPA? Who will take this question, Mr. Lai? Thank you, Mr. Fan, for your question. The government's position is this. Well, actually, we have stated this in the July discussion paper. And that is in relation to the operation of the mainland port area. If we only apply ICQ-related mainland laws, it's not really practical. And that's why we are saying that the full set of the laws of mainland will apply in the MPA, apart from the reserve matters. In this bill, we do not provide any definition of the laws of the mainland. This is giving a general meaning. Our view is that the entire set of laws of the mainland will apply. Your time is exceeded. Your time is up. Anything to add? Our understanding of laws is that they are laws in force at the time. Your time is up. Mr. Chiu, I take second round. Madam Chair, I've just resurfaced from B3 level of West Kowloon XRL station. I am saddened by the fact that a legislator had to sit in protest there for half a day in order to have the chance to have to see the MPA. And we are now said to be people who have no need to do it to see the area, and you collaborate with them because you think that if we don't know how to ask questions, it means there's no question. Why are you laughing, Mr. Wong Kok-hee? Well, it's not an offense, but it's an insult. Well, you bring the insult upon yourself. How so? Mr. Wong Kok-hee, Other members should keep quiet. And please, you can raise your question. You give me the time. A point of order, Mr. Lu. I think when Mr. Chu Hoitik says you colluded with some party, it was an attempt to speculate on your motive. Why do you allow Mr. Lu to the interject? Well, it's a point of order. Well, you are doing the same here, Mr. Ao. Give me back my 1 minute so that I can put my questions. I'll do it. I'm not speculating on her motive. You did say that I colluded with someone. I positioned myself with someone else. Under the rule 41, you should not impute improper motive on a member. If you allow me to clarify, I'm trying to say that your style is the same as Mr. Chen's style. Mr. Frank Chen refused to allow us to inspect the area so that we don't know how to ask questions. And then you say there's no question since we don't know how to put questions. I didn't say that you have a certain secret meetings. I hope you clarify. You would accept this explanation. Well, you are trying to insinuate some matters. All right. You may now put your question. I want to follow up the question raised by Mr. Lam Chek Ting. Please give me back my 30 seconds.
So you mentioned the applicability of the treaties. So have the Hong Kong government notified the signatories of the co-location bill? And have you actually got in touch with the contracting parties? Second, Mr. Chu's question. And as for the applicability of the treaties and conventions and the MPA, are there any potential problems we have communicated with these main authorities? How about the parties to those treaties? Have they been notified? If there is such need? And after the MPA is commissioned, I think the likelihood of thing is actually is small. So you claimed Hong Kong being a world city. So after signing in, Mr. Wu Chi-wai, your turn now. So I'm asking a question for more information, hoping you can provide a checklist, and the answer seems to be no. However, in responding to other colleagues, you tell them they already discussed that with the central government. So, are you lying? Can I ask this? You claim you have no such information, need to compile them after the meeting. Do you have any information at hand, Mr. Mui? Have you ever request them from the central government, and will you ask them in the future, Mr. Mui? So I think Mr. Wu's question was, did the Hong Kong government have any information on the treaties signed by the PRC? Well, the international treaties signed by the Hong Kong government, we do have information, and Mr. Wu's question also has to do with those signed and implemented in the PRC, that we don't have information. I want to clarify that I did not lie. And for those treaties that Hong Kong already is a party to, so if you discuss with the mainland, so mainland may not enforce the the treaty signed by Hong Kong. So what have been discussed in your, if Hong Kong is already a party to the treaties and while the mainland chose not to enforce, and the possibility of such you claimed as small. So you claim you have discussed this, so shouldn't be there a checklist? And second, in case if anything do happen, just in case, so for the Hong Kong government or the court, how can they intervene? Mr. Mui, can you supplement for the applicability of the international treaties? I mentioned it multiple times, if, where necessary. Today we're scrutinizing the bill, so I can just promise anything in the future. If for the treaties negotiated by the central government, I understand, but for those as where Hong Kong is a party, can you provide such a checklist? In my response to Mr. Wu, I already pointed out that the Hong Kong government do have the information on the treaties that which we are a party to. Mr. Dennis Kwok, I would like to ask clause 6 and 7, in which you exclude the jurisdiction. We claim that it's unconstitutional and shouldn't be allowed. However, today we're not discussing this. Have the Bureaus ever studied that any problem that would arisen or the potential legal issues, because it would involve a huge amount of money and there would be a lot of construction cases or arbitration may already begin or about to begin? So after the bill took effect, the authority to, before the commencement will not be affected, or maybe having arbitration or the claims already in the court. After the commencement, how will it affect the arbitration? If the we have come up with the arbitration decision after commencement, and one of the parties went to the going to court to enforce the decision, and said they were already become part of the MPA. So, how would it operate? How is it to do with the which section 6 or 7? Mr. Lai, Deputy Law Officer, we interviewed together with the Article 3 and 7. For paragraph 5, for Article 3, that the establishment of the MPA does not affect the construction rights relating to performance of construction work, service concession operations, as well as regulation of the Hong Kong section. And moving on, and the HKR will continue to handle these matters in accordance with the laws of HKSAR and exercise jurisdiction over these matters in accordance with this cooperation agreement. So on the reserved matters, even after the setup of the MPA, the rights we mentioned will not be affected. They will still regard it as a Hong Kong jurisdiction. And for the actual implementation, for example, enforcing a court order where this article is concerned, could ensure that the court orders can be enforced in the MPA. Mr. Lai? Thank you, Mr. Kwok, for the question. So we can look at Clause 6 of the bill. Except for reserved matters, and split into paragraph A, B, the application of laws in the mainland and of the laws of Hong Kong in the mainland port area. So please, particular attention to be paid by except for reserved matters. So 6.1 would not apply. That the mainland port area was still regarded as inside Hong Kong and still fall under Hong Kong jurisdiction. I'm extending the meeting for 15 minutes. For Clause 6, So except for reserve matters, the mainland port area will be regarded as an area. So we gave her our jurisdiction and we all claimed that this is unconstitutional. So putting this aside, so for the reserve matters, the actual the rights of employees. Let's say the industrial accidents and an employee in safeguarding his labor rights conduct a strike or take industrial action. The operator always fall if it fell within MPA. The mainland station personnel regard it as a security matter, and yet the employees will regard that as a labor rights matter. So who will decide that? How would it be handled? And which, is it Hong Kong or the China court that will handle this, such as these cases? And after this law have been passed, and for the reserve matters, there will still exercise Hong Kong law. For non-reserved matters, they will be subject to the mainland laws. So as for the situation mentioned by Dr. Cheng, we'll do focus on the Article 7, Bracket 3 of the Cooperation Agreement. Care and business relation, tax affairs, and the employment-related obligation, rights and benefits, protection of insurance of the staff members, and all the labor protection and rights regarded as a reserved matter under Hong Kong. According to Article Clause 6.1, that will still see regarded as inside Hong Kong in this case. So the mainland personnel will regard it as a security issue because they think that this industrial accident that will define as affecting the public order or may impact the security where they will intervene because it's fall within the MPA. So who will decide that this is a reserve or a non-reserve matter? After this happened, would Hong Kong or a China court, will this case be heard? Well, we need to look at the facts of each individual case. If this break out, the mainland enforcement security department will look into it. According to Article 7.3 of the Cooperation Agreement, that means the employees' rights and interests will be protected, and they will regard it as falling within Hong Kong jurisdiction. And if the mainland public security officials enforce the law and the Hong Kong employees think that inappropriate, they would complain, and otherwise pursue legal action in the mainland courts. On the issue of communications law, that the network security law is a national law in China, according to the Schedule 1 of this bill. There's no mention of which communications fall within the reserved matter. So it's where it's self-contradictory. So the MPA, where the full set of national laws will be applied, and this network security law is should be applicable. As for whether they applicable in Hong Kong, so when he claims, so for what do you mean by the laws on the mainland in this clause 6. I think we need to look at the section plan. As for the the integrated facilities in the West Coast Station of the construction maintenance and liabilities. So the state in the Article 2.7 that exercising jurisdiction and for the internet service provider in which they provide this day first the entire station they'll be regulated by Hong Kong law. Well, don't see what the problem is. If you put it with under reserve matters, so the network security law is not applicable in Hong Kong. However, this is actually a national law. So to interpret what is a national law, that should be a footnote. Mr. Al, Undersecretary for Security. So for Mr. Chen was referring to the asked information from the Hong Kong Internet Service Provider and what will happen. I believe Mr. Chen's question is on that if a Hong Kong passenger has uploaded something or do something online in the MPA, so the behavior in the passenger in the MPA is not regarded as a reserved matter and they'll be subject to mainland law on jurisdiction. Mr. Nguyen, third round, two minutes. On the security loophole, according to the service cooperation agreement, Article 7, the contractors excluded of the Article 3 the issues under and does affect would that be a laws and it can't even give it the standard operation procedures according to Waste Disposal Ordinance CRAPE 3354 would it fall within that because from the jurisdiction in transferring to us will be subject to relevant ordinance and also a restricted import export rubbish have to be adhere to the base sale question. You've asked you question on refuse on plenty of occasions. Well, rubbish as well, I say is appropriate. So as a former chief of security, I see question very appropriate. I'm asking for it as smuggling of firearms and so on. Madam Chair, he haven't quite answered me. You thought he have answered the question, Madam Chair?
Maybe his answer will be accepted by Mr. Wen. Do you have a standard protocol or arrangement? In respect of train operation, it's inevitable that waste and refuse will be created. But this is a two-way street. And it would be more convenient for Hong Kong to handle waste so generated when they arrive at Hong Kong. And it's more convenient the other way around when the train arrives at mainland station. It's like other transport facilities such as the airport or cruise terminals. The waste to be taken into or out of the MPA that will be subject to security check. I'm not really concerned about waste disposal. I'm concerned about the loophole that people may make use of. You think no arrangement has been mentioned. Are you going to check the waste? Well, that would be the custom clearance procedure. They would be checked by CNE department. Are you going to use X-Guang to check all the bags? If last time you said it would be, if necessary, you would use the X-ray machine to check it. It's subject to the same level of checks like a traveler's baggage. I'm sorry, there are a number of meetings going on at the same time. I see this letter of Mr. Yip Kin Yun on a reserve train. Has this been answered? I don't know what you are referring to. You're talking about this. Oh, I'm sorry, maybe I am preempting this question of Mr. Yip. I'm also concerned about the same matter, but now that he has put this down in writing, I hope you won't mind if I raise this question. And that is to say, for the train compartments in reserve, or when would it become a MPA, part of APA? According to clause 5, a passenger train operations which is in motion, stationary, and during embarkation or disembarkation is regarded as part of the West Kowloon Station mainland port area. If the location is a reserve train, is somewhere between the Futian and West Kowloon Station, when would it become part of the port, mainland port area? This is a letter from Mr. Yip Kin Yun, dated the 27th of April. Well, we received it rather late in the day. It is 6:46 p.m. Do you understand the questions, Mr. Ngao? Last time when I answered questions on emergencies, I talk about the operator would provide, would make available certain reserve trains for passengers if necessary. The reserve train will be either or standby in on standby. The train on standby will be in Futian or West Kowloon Station. The train will be regarded as a part of the mainland port area. So the standby train will be a port, mainland port area all the time. If it's on the track, it will be within Hong Kong port area. Is that the case that it would suddenly become a mainland port area? Well, if you look at cross 5-1 is about mainland port area, and 5-2 is about Hong Kong port area. The train on standby will be part of the mainland port area. And when the passenger disembarks from a train and board this stamp train or reserve train, the passenger will have left the mainland port area, enter the Hong Kong port area, and board the train, which is a mainland port area. The immigration director of immigration is authorized to provide the clearance after the event. I want to talk about Article 7.5 of the cooperation agreement, and that is taxation, commercial arrangements, and trade contracts. Would be subject to mainland laws under such an arrangement. Mr. Lai, I think Mr. Ngao is referring to paragraph 5 of Article 5. We have to pay attention to the relevant parties, who are parties to the civil agreement. We talk about operators and operators, contractors, and so on. Only these people and staff members. And this paragraph 5 only applies to these people, operators, service providers, staff members, and so on and so forth. Many members are asked questions about the applicability of international treaties or insurance. And there are certain treaties and conventions which have to do with trade cooperation or tax. You cannot say that it is not related to the operator. And insurance can affect staff members and operators and service providers. How can you say that, that it will not be a big problem? You are going to give us a list on the applicability of a certain IOs, I think. Mr. Mui, on the applicability of international treaty, we are not saying that they are not important. We have discussed the matter with the CPG. My previous answer is that setting up of the chances of having problems would be very low after setting up the MPA. I want to talk about 6 bracket 2, clause 6 bracket 2, and that is section 1 does not affect the boundary of the administrative division of the Hong Kong SAR. But for the Sam John Bay area ordinance, although there's something similar to the clause 6 bracket 1, and that is for the purpose of the application of Hong Kong laws. The Hong Kong Sam John Bay Hong Kong port area is regarded as lying within Hong Kong. But it doesn't mention that the boundary of the administrative division of Hong Kong SAR will not be affected. That is to say, in that Sam John Bay ordinance, we don't have something like 6 bracket 2. Well, I can say something, and then I would invite Mr. Pang from the law drafting division to supplement. We are saying that by having the 6 bracket 2, things are clearer. We would make it clear that the boundary will not be affected. This is for the purpose of avoidance of disputes, and it also reflects the decision of the MPCSC on the setting up of the MPA. But actually, the Sam John Bay, the Hong Kong port area, will not affect the boundary of the Hong Kong SAR. Why do we need to specify this in the form of clause 6 bracket 2? This also reflects the decision of the MPCSC. So you mean it's affected, if not for the MPCSC decision, the boundary is affected? Clause 6 bracket 2 stipulates that the boundary of Hong Kong SAR is not affected. Although this is not in the Sum Chun Bay ordinance, we are of the view that the boundary of Hong Kong SAR is also not affected. All right, that's what we have got for Clause 6. If members want to move amendments, please give them to me as soon as possible, or I may not be able to accept them. Please give them to me by the close of business on Wednesday. Next time we are going to move on to Clause 7, because some questions raised today are already related to Clause 7. Thank you.